Hey, this is Kurt Othmer from EEG Info, and I want to take just a moment to introduce you to the new report for EEG Expert and QIK Test. One of the reasons we have a new report is there is a new norm, and the new norm is based on a much newer, more recent, and larger normative base. So where the old norm was about 30 years ago and had a much smaller population, this new modern norm has a much larger population behind it, something like 20,000 records, and so a huge population, which means many, many more subjects in each given bin. And this also means it's much more recent. We have, as people, become a lot faster, so more recent norm makes sense for that. So let me show you a few of the things that we have here on the report. First of all, here at the top, there's a little description of the test. We have here this new performance index and accuracy index. So the old numbers that you're used to seeing, like 82 here for speed of response, 112 for consistency of response, these are these old variables that you're used to. So speed of response is reflected down here in these numbers with response time. And 112 here, consistency of response, is reflected here in variability. So these are the numbers that you're used to seeing. These have now been combined into this performance index, which really gives you one solid number to look at that just gives you an index of performance. Same over here with accuracy index. So 112, this then combines 105 here for sustained attention. This is omission errors and outliers. And you see those here. Omission errors and outliers. And one of the really neat things that's happened here is that we've included outliers. So one of the great things about this data set, this normative base, and other CPT research is that outliers correlate with omission errors. So this allows us to combine them. And this is really important because omission errors, especially as we get to be functional grown-ups, we tend not to make a lot of omission errors. They're just pretty rare. Remember, an omission error is not clicking when you were supposed to click. So this is omitting a response. You're not going when you're supposed to go, and you're not pressing the button when you're supposed to go. So that's pretty rare. Most of us don't make that kind of mistake in our day-to-day lives. And an outlier is just, oh, I was going to respond, I just responded late. And if it's late enough, then we classify it as an outlier. And then we lump those omissions and outliers together into this sustained attention. And then that gets combined with commissions and anticipatory errors into this accuracy index. So now we have sort of impulse control here. Anticipatory errors, you're probably familiar with from the last test. Anticipatory errors, that's responding too fast, faster than your brain could have really figured this out. So within 150 milliseconds. So that's really faster than our brain can decide, yes, this is a target I'm gonna press. No, this is a non-target I'm not gonna press. The brain can't have really figured it out that fast. So that's an anticipatory error when you just see a light and press. That's more reaction time. So that's anticipatory. So the anticipatory errors and commission errors, again, committing an error, so pressing when you weren't supposed to press, those get combined into this accuracy index. So we have these two really nice indices right at the top that give you a measure of where this person is at, just a real broad perspective. Where is this person at? And that's also a nice measure of change when we have the next report, hopefully after 20 sessions of neurofeedback, for instance. We have a little colored graph here that shows you where you are on that performance index and on the accuracy index. Now, let's scroll down and see a little bit more about the test. I started to introduce you to these measures, and again, these are familiar from the last test with the addition of this outlier responses. And so outliers are an addition here, but again, they correlate with the omissions, so that is similar data that you're familiar with. Then we have the commissions. Again, a commission is committing the error, pressing when you were not supposed to press. Response time, that's how fast you pressed. So again, we want to see that lower, right? The faster you do that, the better. And again, the goal of the test is to be both fast and accurate. And then here is variability, which is the spread of the distribution. So if somebody has a lot of very, very fast presses and a lot of very, very slow presses, then they're going to have a lot of a very large number here. So we have the actual measured value. This person here had one omission error, one outlier, zero commission errors, a response time of 450 milliseconds, and a variability of 59.9 milliseconds. We can see then the median of the distribution. So this gives you a little sense of where the norm is versus where this person is. So the norm, we're looking at 1.8 errors versus this person's one error. That puts her slightly above average on the standard score at 106. So 100 is average on the standard score. So slightly above the norm at 106. And that puts her in the 65th percentile. So again, percentile is over 100. Let me spend just a moment more on percentile because we can see some interesting numbers that happen here. And you may recall, those of you who used the old norm, that we would get this standard score of 0 and the percentile of 0 or 1. And the issue there is that was a comparison with the old norm. And the old norm in some age brackets would literally just have a few people, and those few people would have no mistakes in the norm, no omission errors at all. And so if somebody made one omission error, that would be hugely punished by the database because it just said, we don't have a comparison to this. Nobody else made any mistakes. So the fact that you've made one mistake takes you outside of the realm of what the data set allows. Now we have such a larger data set that we can really compare that. So we can see more at every age group. We can see, okay, here's one error. Here's where you lie. However, the fact remains that omission errors, as I mentioned before, are still rare. And so sometimes in several of the age groups and genders, across the genders, we have essentially 100% success is really easy. And so there, you might have zero errors for omission errors, and you still might just be at the 70th percentile. And you're saying, well, wait a minute, why am I not at the 99th percentile? Why is that not the best possible score? And well, the truth is, what we should really write there is something like, you're in the 70th to the 100th percentile. You're in the top 30% is what that means. So instead of saying you're at the 99th or you're at the 70th, we just say you're at the 70th percentile. But what it really means is you are in the top 30% somewhere, but it's hard to say where because nobody made errors in that top 30%. So you can't really be compared. It's just you're in the top 30%. So that's a number that you might see. And so even if somebody is in that 70th percentile for making zero errors, that's not a bad thing. That's the best possible score you can get for that age and gender. Let's move down the test here, down the report. This section breaks out the numbers that you've already seen, and it breaks them into the five periods and the three sections. So you might recall from the test that there is two slow sections, two fast sections, and a slow section. It feels like a slow segment of the test, and then it gets fast, and then it gets slow. It's actually not getting faster or slower. What's happening is we're getting stimulus infrequent in both of these sections. So there's just not a lot of targets. And then we get stimulus frequent. So there's just a lot of targets to press. And then again, stimulus infrequent. And so slow, fast, slow. This gives us a great opportunity to see how people at the beginning of the slow section and the end of the slow section, how they handle getting in and out of a new task, how they change task into the next section, and handle the sustained task in that high performance section, and then handle the transition into the next task. We take that same data and just process it differently. So this period one and period two combine to be section one. So we can look at the data as a section, we can look at the data as two periods, but it's the same exact thing. So we're going to see essentially this 505 and the 481 combine to be on average 493 here if we combine those two into one section. So that combines there. And then, of course, this combines the average of all of taken as five together or taken as three together. That averages out to the same thing, this 450 response time here. Here we see that one omission error that we talked about. That one omission error here is in the low demand here in the fifth period, and that's reflected here in the total. That one outlier was in the second high demand, and that then is reflected here in section two and here in the total. So it's just the same number repeated here, here, and here. So we're taking the same data that we just had at the top. Scroll up and show that to you. So the same data that we had in summary here, we're now breaking it down into the five periods, three sections, and the total. Now we go down into the standard scores, broken out in the same manner, into the five periods, three sections, and total. The standard scores will change color, as will the raw data here. They'll change color if you break 120 on the standard score or if you break 80 on the standard score. That gives you a green number if we break 120, and it gives you a red number if we break 80. There's a couple other spots where you'll see red numbers, such as post-commission response time, for instance, that'll turn red, anticipatory responses, multiple responses, and so forth. They'll turn red. Those post-commission response times will turn red if you sped up after making a mistake. We'll talk about that in just a moment. So, omission errors, commission errors, response time, variability. Now we are seeing the standard scores for each one of these. And again, 100 is average, and 120 is significantly above average, 80 is significantly below. We can see that explanation up here near the in the explanations at the top of the test. Scores significantly below average or less than 80 are printed in red, and scores significantly above average, 120, are printed in green. Here we have other responses on the test. Anticipatory responses, again, we talked about this. This is responding within 150 milliseconds. And reasonably, your brain can't do that for you. Responding within 150 milliseconds is guessing. You just can't respond that fast. Multiple responses, this is pressing multiple times within a 2 second period, within a 2 second press. So pressing both buttons at once or pressing twice, pressing one button twice. So multiple responses will be counted here. And then post-commission response time, which I just started to mention, is how fast you are on the next press after making a mistake. So you make a mistake, you've got a target, the target, and then a non-target, and you press on that non-target. So you've just made a mistake. How fast are you on the next target that you press? We look at that. We're supposed to slow down, and in some cases, people speed up after making a mistake. Now, we can speed up for lots of different reasons, so we need to sort of bring a clinical judgment to why somebody speeds up, but it is definitely something we want to draw your attention to. The next section of the test breaks these same numbers that I've already showed you, breaks them down into pretty graphs. They look great to print out and give this to the client, for instance. There's the standard score for sustained attention. We already saw that above. This is just graphed. Impulse control, speed of response, consistency of response, etc. Now we take the same numbers that we saw above, broken down by period, section, and total. So again, just a graph of the numbers that we already saw. This next segment is my favorite segment of the test because this actually breaks down every single key press in the test. This is wonderful because you can really see patterns. You can see where somebody slowed down. You can see where they sped up. You can ask questions. Oh, wow, I see this place here where you really sped up. What was going on there? Or I see a place where you really slowed down. Was there a distraction in the room? Did something happen? And that can also allow for an advanced conversation of, yeah, you know, that was when that dog was barking and I really wasn't even looking at the test. And so a clinician can really put a judgment on that of, okay, that's a different significance than, wow, I didn't have any idea that I just missed 10 targets in a row and I thought I was hitting every single one. And so that's a very different conversation. And again, bringing your clinical judgment to those. And that's something we talk about in the assessment practicum weekend that we do. We spend a lot of time talking about the interpretation and the clinical interpretation of the data. But it's wonderful that it's here and that we can see it and we can see how somebody handles a new task and processes jumping into a new task, handles this sustaining a task for this long, boring time frame. Here we see our outlier. This person slowed way down here and crossed this green outlier line of 770 milliseconds. That's what's relevant for this age and gender, for this the segment of the norm. We see this slow outlier here, and that was counted. Here we almost had an outlier. And then here we had a full omission error in this fifth period. This is kind of interesting. We're seeing full omission errors in this fifth period sometimes. And it's wonderful that the quick test has this fifth period that is a slow segment of the test, that we aren't running fast all the way to the end of the test, which can keep people activated and awake. We have this slow segment. Once they're tired and they've handled this long, boring 20-minute task, now we throw this slow challenge at them, which can be even more challenging for people to hang in there through. And so we do see more omission errors. So I'm really pleased with the quick test for that reason amongst many. Here we see the variability mapped out so clearly, and we can see in this individual the outlier and, well, we don't see the omission error, of course, but we can see the outlier here. So we see those slow responses, we see those fast responses, we can see what that distribution looks like. We also see each individual period broken down and what the distribution of speeds looks like. We're breaking down all five periods here, and then at the top, we of course have the total. The norm here, 373 milliseconds for this age and gender, is shown with the blue circle. The mean of the test, so this person's score, is in this case slower than the norm overall, and we can see that this person is slower there. And we can see how they did in each individual period and how much slower they are from the norm. Here it's more than in this period, for instance. So we can see how they did versus the norm in each given period. And then here they slowed down again, and then here's this fifth period. Notice everybody across the norm tends to slow down again in this fifth period, because then it's stimulus infrequent, which lulls us into slowing down. We also see the anticipatory responses here. Here's that 150 millisecond line cutoff. If somebody were to respond faster than 150 milliseconds, we would categorize that as anticipatory. And here we would categorize this as an outlier. This is the wonderful pre-post segment of the test. So if you upload a second quick test for the same individual, then you end up with a second bar graph. And in this case, this is a sample for this video, so this isn't real stuff. So this is rather arbitrary. So I apologize, this is not a pretty example, but hopefully you get to see a nice change. We put the newer test behind so that hopefully as the scores go up, which we expect them to do, we'll actually see the scores be higher there in the back. So we'll see them go up as they go extend into the distance. So we actually put the newer test in back. It's important to know. And then we see all those performance index, speed of response, consistency of response, which is part of the performance index. And then we have the accuracy index, sustained attention, and impulse control, which is part of the accuracy index. So we see all that mapped out and graphed for the person. Then we actually see score development, which actually breaks down the two dates we have for the tests and breaks down the omission errors, commission errors, outliers, and anticipatory responses across those two graphs. And we can sort of see that score development. This is a really important segment of the test, and this text automatically pops up when we upload the test, and this gives you some wonderful guideposts. I think as I teach this report a lot, some people can take this a little too hard. We talk about frontal dysfunction, you know, not quite so literally, but we're more talking about areas of focus, areas to concentrate on. Let's think about frontal function as an important area where we might want to train with neurofeedback. Not that this is some severe debilitating issue, but more that this is an area we might think about. So I often coach people based on feedback that I get, not to take this too hard. Don't be too rough on yourself with it, but it is, we all can make mistakes on the quick test, so it's easy to be too hard on ourselves. So a little coaching there, if I may. But in any case, this is a really, really useful text that pops up and gives really, really helpful guidance in understanding what you're seeing in the test. And that is a quick and simple walkthrough. This is a real brief overview. I haven't spent a lot of time on this. I haven't gone real in depth, but I just wanted to give you a real brief overview. I haven't talked about using the quick test here, and there are other videos for that. And again, really understanding the interpretation and then how we apply this to neurofeedback is something that we put a lot of time and energy into, especially in our assessment practicum weekend. That's an important time when we address all of this. So definitely consider that. Consider many of the avenues that we and educational opportunities that we offer for training in this and understanding how to clinically apply this in a neurofeedback context. Thank you so much.